more easily be sold as a slave to the buyer, since there was no particular connection to the citizen. The more affordable and until a master be executed and emotionally powerful nature type is indicative of the widespread appeal and popularity of Rembrandt's work. So often when looking at art, our initial visual advice is to recognize what's in front of us, and if we don't, we'll just move on. What I'd like to do is slow down our active looking, take a look at this painting, and try to give time to our eyes and our brain to connect, keeping that initial visual reflex in first gear. So I'll start by doing a brief visual or a brief formal analysis, which will describe the picture in front of you, and we'll take it from there. So we have an aged man, his picture at the center of the frame, his head almost meets up in the middle. There's a ray of light projected from an unseen source from the top left corner of the painting, illuminating the old man's face and the right, illuminating the old man's forehead and the right side of his face. The rest of his body is almost entirely black, sloping downwards from his ears to the corners of the picture. The background is blank and a shade lighter than the old man's hat and clothes, clearly delineating the figure's silhouette despite the monochrome hat. Draped in black, the old man's face and ears stand out the most. Strong contrast between light and dark, the term we call chiaroscuro, is not a new technique in the 17th century. In fact, the influence of the 16th century Italian painter Caravaggio is felt throughout Rembrandt's work, whereas Caravaggio is known for his graphic and extreme use of light. Here, Rembrandt relies on this technique in order to focus his study on the details of the figure's face. The viewer can unmistakably recognize the wrinkles on the forehead, the creases deepened by the furrowed brow, sparse, wispy gray hair streaking out from under his hat, the slightly deflated and darkened eyelids, drooping skin around the nose and the cheeks. All of this is supported by a single, high-placed, downcast of the veil. When we look even closer, the naturalistic rendering of the figure's facial features is carefully built up with multiple layers of paint. We refer to this build-up Each brushstroke helps to describe subtle variations of skin pigmentation of different shading, where the tissue is thinner or fattier, redder or paler. Rembrandt studies closely the effects of different shading on different parts of the figure's facial structure, going from a creaky glow in the most bulbous parts of his forehead toward a darker or faded palette as the features recede away from the light. Look, for example, at the strands of the old man's beard that face the light. The colors vary between pure white, pale gray, kind of a faded yellow, much like you see in real life with sunlight or candlelight, can bring out different colored glimmers in a single strand of hair. Rembrandt captured the minute details and even incised single strands of eyebrow hairs into the thick layers of paint. We see this in a true tool of gloves, of the two or three concrete gold strands that stick out just above his left eye, where the bushy, wiry eyebrow hairs project forward and seem to adjust to catch the light, even though with all shadows of the garbage. The careful placement of color is how Rembrandt makes the viewer understand on a two-dimensional plane, a figure that interacts and is affected by light in a three-dimensional manner. So what we just did, we slowed down our active looking on a formal basis. When I say formal, I'm talking about composition, light,